Wait, Justin. All right, now.
Yeah, yeah. Perhaps anyway, we should have 5 minutes break or just go on.
All right, let's give it a few minutes.
It seems to me that 5 minutes can be reasonable. I mean, I'm not taking responsibility or taking control of this, but it seems to me that basically for everybody, it's going to be nice. Yeah. Should we begin or should we wait a little bit more? Begin? Yeah. Okay. I'm glad to present Professor Joachim Rother from Stockholm University. He mainly worked in Irish studies, especially on Jane Benwell. And he also explores contemporary novel in English more generally, without any primary emphasis on national boundaries, phenomenology, postmodernism, aesthetics, and theology are overarching topics of his scholarly work. Some of the most recent publications have been, on Irish literature as world literature, once again on Benwell, on Joyce, Yeats, and Beckett, the postmodern Gothic, the Irish Gothic, John Williams, Tom McCarthy, aesthetics, and the posthuman zeitgeist. Professor Wethert has also done work on René Girard and G.A., especially on language theories of Eric Gans. You're almost welcome.
Thank you very much for the introduction. First of all, do you hear me clearly? Very good, because I bought a new microphone today because I wanted to make a good impression audio-wise. And now next problem here to see if I can share my screen and make clear that I share the sound properly. And then it should be, I have, as usual, several screens going, so see. So can you see that?
Yeah.
I can't see you. So how do I get you back here on the, maybe I can't. Because now I only see my full screen, the PowerPoint. It would be nice to see you. How do I get that?
Show video panel.
Right. Now I see at least Roman and Dennis and Eric and Richard, mm-hmm. although he's not in. He's eating his lunch, I heard. Okay. So I will show some clips, and I hope that this will work because it's in a way based on a few clips, but then I'll read some quotes as well, but I have those on the screen for you as well, so I hope that you will be able to follow. So Bret Easton Ellis's modern classic American Psycho clearly has very time-specific aspects of its setup. However, it also has dimensions that probe into capitalism and human desire on a more universal level. These are aspects that cannot be limited to the yuppie era, which stereotypically highlights the frivolous celebration of capitalism as an aesthetic, albeit empty, phenomenon. I would claim that the narrative is extreme in such a way that it creates a specific theoretical space that cannot be completely contained by metaphor, symbolism, or allegory. That space will be roughly mapped out in what follows. By theoretical space, I mean neither something abstract nor something concrete. Let's make sure that I can change the image. It is rather a minimalist space of nodes, vectors, and forces. However, these forces affect any type of reality, either real or fictional. This short paper shall depict the space through a palimpsest of three theories, Girard, Gans, and Oswald de Andrade. The last one being a perhaps lesser known figure is a Brazilian 20th century philosopher. Thus, the paper has three parts and each one represents one layer in hypertheory space. First one might seem to be the most obvious one. Girard's theory about mimetic desire is blatantly present in the narrative's overall structure. I shall here make use of the film both for entertainment value and hopefully quick clarity. Please pay attention to the pent-up violence that is skillfully implemented in the scene.
Patrick, thanks so much for looking after Courtney. Dorcia, how impressive. How on earth did you get a reservation there?
Lucky, I guess.
That's a wonderful suit. Don't tell me, let me guess. Valentino Couture.
Uh-huh.
You look so soft.
Your compliment was sufficient, Louis.
Hello, Halber Stram.
Nice tie.
How the hell are you?
Alan has mistaken me for this dickhead Marcus Halberstram. It seems logical because Marcus also works at PNP and in fact does the same exact thing I do. He also has a penchant for Valentino's suits and Oliver People's glasses. Marcus and I even go to the same barber, although I have a slightly better haircut.
So how's the ransom account going, Marcus?
It's all right.
Really? That's interesting. It's not great.
Oh, well, you know.
So how's Cecilia? She's a great girl.
Oh, yeah. I'm very lucky.
Mm-hmm.
Hey, Alan. Congratulations on the Fisher account.
Thank you, Baxter.
Listen, Paul, squash.
Call me.
What, Friday?
No can do. I got an 8:30 res at Dorcia. Great. Sea urchin ceviche.
Dorcia on Friday night? How'd he swing that?
I think he's lying.
Is that a gram?
New card. What do you think?
Whoa. Very nice. Look at that.
Picked them up from the printers yesterday.
Good coloring.
That's bone. And the lettering is something called Cillian Rail.
It's very cool, Bateman, but that's nothing. Look at this.
That is really nice.
Eggshell with Romalian type. What do you think?
Nice. Jesus, that is really super. How'd a nitwit like you get so tasteful?
I can't believe.
In addition to the aggression pulsing just under the surface, the micro level of minimal distinction is noteworthy. The minuscule differences between the cards enhance the force of mimetic desire. It is almost as if the object disappears. It just has to be there as a minimal node point of reference, since the agents are occupied by the competition of ranking each other in relation to one another. The scene clearly illustrates the autonomous character of this force. In addition, we notice how the object becomes endowed with value as a consequence of the powers of desire, which in all is a phenomenon we recognize from situations of children's play, the dark side of Homo ludens. A certain toy may suddenly become the most precious thing on the playground, but not until the trajectories of desire become explicit. The theme of pent-up violence is emphasized in the narrative by the protagonist's ludicrous motivations of subjective rankings of popular music works. However, what is clear is that at least on a superficial level, violence is depicted as the underlying force of the seemingly tidy capitalist organization of desire.
You like Huey Lewis in the news?
They're okay.
Their early work was a little too new wave for my taste. But when Sports came out in 83, I think they really came into their own, commercially and artistically. The whole album has a clear, crisp sound and a new sheen of consummate professionalism
that really gives the songs a big boost.
He's been compared to Elvis Costello, but I think Huey has a far more bitter, cynical sense of humor.
Hey, Halberstram.
Yes, Alan?
Why are there copies of the style section all over the place? Do you have a dog? A little chow or something?
No, Alan.
Is that a raincoat?
Yes, it is. In 87, Huey released this. Their most accomplished album. I think their undisputed masterpiece is Hip to Be Square. A song so catchy, most people probably don't listen to the lyrics. But they should, because it's not just about the pleasures of conformity and the importance of trends. It's also a personal statement about the band itself. Hey, Paul!
Remaining on this level of our theoretical palimpsest in hyper-theoretical space, we could explain the whole narrative in terms of it making explicit the violence that underpins any capitalist civilization. In that theoretical scenario, Patrick incarnates the patriarchal phallus, and on all levels of the narrative, he just confirms his masculine status. He incarnates the aggressive phallus. In having ritualized emotionless sex with women that are looked upon as empty dolls, Bateman would further consolidate the validity of such a theory. It would be a depiction of the capitalist machine as primarily following the principle of the father, the male phallic violence at the core of the capitalist order. In the film, this is stressed by means of the narcissist behavior of the protagonist, mirrors and fictionalized filming within the film that reify the kingdom of projection, that is the order of commodification made manifest and sustained. In all, this phenomenon partly explains why images were and are so dominant in our late capitalist era. The violence here pushes us in the direction of Gams's primary scene. The deferral of violence is partly achieved in terms of the ontological ambiguity that underpins the whole narrative. The audience cannot know what is fiction and what might be potentially real. What is in Bateman's mind and what actually happens on the plane of the narrative? That question could only be answered by adding more fiction to the existing fiction. However, in the hyper-theoretical space, we do not have to, indeed we cannot, eradicate any layer. The stratas are complementary to each other. A scholar well-versed in Gans's theory would realize that the actual consumption of the female would collapse the whole setup. The object of desire cannot be eaten, but it could very well be fictionalized as being eaten. This layer of our theoretical space then confirms and partly explicates the prevailing fictional versus real ambiguity. If the cannibalism is fictionalized by the schizophrenic Bateman, then the primary scene may be the layer in our theoretical space that holds up the whole building. But what about the father? Is the bottom line that American Psycho solely confirms the domination of the patriarchal phallogocentric logic? This is exactly where this narrative adds a more complex layer to the already established ones. Patriarchal logic of the master father is strongly manifested in the step from anthropophagy to conquering and enslaving, as formulated by Luis Felipe Garcia. The contrast can help us understand how Andrade presents the transition from the economy of a matriarchal society to the one of a patriarchal one. Indeed, as he affirms the Brazilian philosopher, the historic rupture with the matriarchal world happened when man stopped devouring his other in order to enslave him. From the advent of this practice of enslavement derived the division of labor and the organization of society in classes. In other words, the transition from a tribe-based society with no private property to a patriarchal family-based one with private property is operated through the enslavement of the members of the tribe so as to force them to work not for themselves, but for a master who will profit from the fruits of their labor. Andrade and Garcia's point here sheds an interesting interpretative light on the cannibalism in American Psycho. Since the whole narrative reads as a manifestation of the patriarchal capitalism, the anthropophagic aspect needs to be explained. If it only symbolizes the devouring of the appetitive object, the whole fiction would collapse, but it does not. Therefore, we need an alternative explanation in the hyper-theoretical space. This explanation has to be able to coexist with the aforementioned theories of mimetic desire and the primary scene. Interestingly, these aspects of the written work could not be represented in the film, or rather perhaps were chosen not to be. If they were, they would have to be strongly veiled by fictionalizing filters. Otherwise, such outrageous rituals would jeopardize the ambiguity tensions that are so carefully built up. However, in our positive theoretical space, Andrade and Garcia's suggestion becomes relevant. The ultimate transgression is clad in the same absurd consumerist and popular cultural references as much else in the narrative. In the kitchen, I tried to make meatloaf out of the girl, but it becomes too frustrating a task, and instead I spend the afternoon smearing her meat all over the walls, chewing on strips of skin I ripped from her body. Then I rest by watching a tape of last week's new CBS sitcom, Murphy Brown. After that, in a large glass of JMB, I'm back in the kitchen. Head in the microwave is now completely black and hairless, and I place it in a tin pot on the stove in an attempt to boil any remaining flesh I forgot to shave off. Heaving the rest of her body into a garbage bag, my muscles slathered with Bengay, easily handling the dead weight, I decide to use whatever is left of her for a sausage of some kind. If we disregard the almost comedy-like layer of the narration and the simplistic reading of capitalism as the beast under the polished surface, we need to process also what this means in the hyper-theoretical space. That does not have any ethical presumptions, not even that it is the ultimate taboo to eat your own kind. Anthropophagy then has to be seen as a pure ritual that presents another layer in hyper-theoretical space. So philosophically, the reader is either consciously or subconsciously being made aware of a vision that functions as a challenge to the patriarchal capitalist phallogocentric order as formulated by Garcia. The culture opposed to messianism is, as we have seen, the one that is consolidated within matriarchal societies, namely anthropophagy. It's important to highlight, as the Brazilian philosopher carefully does, that anthropophagy is not to be understood as the practice of pure cannibalism, that is, the practice of eating human flesh out of gluttony or hunger, but rather as something associated to the ritual practices of native tribes for which the consumed flesh represents a vision of the world, a vision that, through the ritualized process of deglutition, is incorporated and transfigured into a new vision within a sort of epistemic metamorphosis. As a consequence, anthropophagy is to be understood as a Weltanschauung aiming at perceiving existence from the perspective of alterity, a vision according to which the world is a space containing numerous perceptual bodies that should be incorporated so that we can progressively engender more comprehensive visions of existence. Thus, it is as a layer of vision or Weltanschauung that we may see anthropophagy as an escape way out of the capitalist nightmare. Moreover, this vision is strongly dependent on the fictional ambiguity. Presumably, cannibalism is not even real on the fictional plane of the narrative about Patrick Bateman. Thus, the thought of the excess of consumerism contains the vision of its self-destruction, the abandoning of all enslavement. However, we must also acknowledge the narrative's own existential darkness. This tension comes out in the hyper-theoretical space too. The positive aspect of the narrative and anthropophagy can only reveal itself as an idea. Indeed, Patrick Bateman is an idea.
Then I apply an herb mint facial mask, which I leave on for 10 minutes while I prepare the rest of my routine. I always use an aftershave lotion with little or no alcohol because alcohol dries your face out and makes you look older. Then moisturizer, then an anti-aging eye balm followed by a final moisturizing protective lotion. There is an idea of a Patrick Bateman, some kind of abstraction. But there is no real me. only an entity, something illusory. And though I can hide my cold gaze, and you can shake my hand and feel flesh gripping yours, and maybe you can even sense our lifestyles are probably comparable, I simply am not there.
If then Bateman is an idea, we're able to confirm one of the layers in hypotheoretical space, which is the production of fiction as an outlet to Gans's primary scene. To be sure, this also draws attention to the human obsession with fictive violence. Thus, American Psycho can perfectly well be read as a dream rather than a nightmare. The vision of anthropophagy as the restoring of matriarchal alternatives is a Weltanschauung worth acknowledging. The dark ending is then not so dark. The no exit is, of course, denoting the no exit from fiction. Well, though I know I should have done that instead of not doing it, I'm 27 for Christ's sakes, and this is how life presents itself in a bar or in a club in New York, maybe anywhere at the end of the century, and how people, you know, me behave, and this is what being Patrick means to me, I guess. So, well, yep, poo. And this is followed by a sigh, then a slight shrug, and another sigh. And above one of the doors, covered by red velvet drapes in Harry's, is a sign. And on the sign, in letters that match the drape's color, are the words, "This is not an exit." This is how American Psycho ends, and this is how this paper ends. Thank you.
Thank you very much for an amazing talk. And I see a couple of hands raised, and I also have a couple of questions myself. So it's Bill, please. I've seen the raised side by Bill Capitan and then by Matt Schneider.
I was just, that was just my applause symbol.
Ah, I see. Sorry.
Yes, I was applauding as well.
Yeah, sorry. Okay, any questions, please?
Well, it's good if you don't have any questions, because I can't answer any questions.
Yeah, in this case, I do have questions. I mean, at least one that I'm familiar with the movie, but I never had an experience of thinking about it from this direction, and it was amazing. And it seems to me what you said in all different directions goes far beyond this film specifically. And my question was, in addition to this moment of ambivalence and the containing of this complex and ambivalent relation between desire and violence, and that it cannot be eaten, it still strikes me that the postmodern culture we belong to somehow tends to undo this primary sin, to dramatize obsessively the undoing of this sin, still ambivalently, still partially, still in a sense that can be interpreted in different ways. But it seems to me this kind of film was impossible 50 years ago, as far as I know. And basically, I just want to ask what's your opinion on this? Is this something that is, I'm just making this up, or it's in the material itself?
I lived with this narrative. I read it as a fairly young man in the early 90s, and I was sort of horrified, of course, that as many were when it came out. So, but then I felt that my understanding of it hadn't really developed. You know, I thought that maybe there must be something. I mean, since it is established as a modern classic, you know, there's something that attracts our interest. And I try to sort it out, I think, with the three layers. And this cannibalism idea becomes complicated when one combines it with the ambiguity of the narrative and the that we really don't know what is sort of actually happening and what is in Patrick's mind. So when reading the novel, you really think that he, and maybe seeing the film as well, you really think that he kills, some other things are planted there with ambiguity, but that he kills this companion here that we saw in this axe scene. But then that's also problematized towards the end of the narrative, that someone says that they've seen Paul Allen in London or something like that. So almost everything is dubious and ambiguous. So I thought that with the cannibalism, then, in order to try to say something more than the most obvious, that it's devouring of the other us, just the capitalist machine consuming everything until nothing is left. I thought that this combination of Gantz and anthropophagy theory of Andrade's sort of gave it a little bit of an interpretative twist. But then, I mean, it's really difficult to think of cannibalism as something good.
Thank you. I mean, I also remember this first experience of reading the book and seeing the movie, which was horrifying, absolutely shocking, and somehow taking beyond the boundaries of something that we can somehow we can face in any reasonable way. And and this interpretative twist, thank you, because I with all the shocking experience, I was never able to think about this from this direction, and it's really a different direction. And questions, comments, ideas, suggestions? Is it only because of the late hour? We're just tired, and or probably the material itself is somehow is not the kind of material we're happy to deal with usually.
Don't mind then, if I may. Yes, of course, the problem, the subject of cannibalism is very deeply present in anthropological, all kind of anthropological research. And in a very simplified version, it was always connected to primary societies which eat the others, so those who don't belong to us. And thanks to GA, we could probably say that the role of language and culture, which develops in more developed societies than those primary, is really an answer how to live, to prolong and to sustain your existence, not eating the others. But it is a very simple answer. But now, looking at all this, what Joachim presented, it looks much more complicated than I thought before. I thought that it is just a simple, you know, feast because of the victory of one side above the other. But it doesn't look like that, because these relations are very dense And maybe it is the universal problem of this primary violence, which is maybe deeply constituted in human organism. And as far we are from the first moment when our culture grows, so partly this desire disappears. But here we have contemporary culture, which is well developed, and still those very primary reactions are present. So I really ask myself what kind of model and what kind of answer we could find. But maybe one of the most useful would be to use GA and function of language and culture, which are still developing it. But isn't it closely connected to the psychology of modern man? Maybe that's why this situation is so complicated, because all kinds of desires, aesthetics, and also action of productive society, which wants to show up your hierarchy. But what is the solution? So it is the question, what is the solution for culture and society to rise above all these kind of primary actions and behavior? So it would be my vision. But it's very hard subject. I really admire you that you can read those pieces, because it's really sometimes very emotional. When you read it, I felt very small and really fearing reading that.
Professor Ganz, please.
Well, I mean, I assume the speaker might want to answer Magdalena's question first. I don't know.
Joachim, please.
Well, no. It was more of a reflection. And I think that the problem I ran into, I mean, for myself, is I just combined ideas in trying to solve a philosophical kind of problem for myself. I still have problems seeing, even as an idea, I mean, it sounds good to consume the other instead of enslaving him. But it's also very difficult to think about, even in terms of a symbolic or ritual kind of way. And I mean, there is no doubt how sort of our culture has dealt with cannibalism historically. It's, as you say, it's been the primitives that they're not civilized enough, you know. So Andrade's ideas then try to problematize that a bit. Eric, maybe.
Yes.
Well, first of all, I'm struck by the fact that you mentioned that you called the originary hypothesis a primary scene. I think there is a sense in which somehow the Girardian scene of scapegoat murder gets assimilated somehow. The whole point of GA is that the human is based on deferral of violence. That doesn't mean, of course, you always thought of me as a kind of Pollyanna, you know. You say, oh, Gan doesn't really understand violence. But the fact is that all human violence is based on the fact that we deferred it at the beginning so that we could keep developing all these nice weapons. And of course, now we, you know, there's a kind of dialectic, but the point is it's always deferral of violence. I'm not a great expert on these anthropological matters, but I am familiar with the thesis that Marvin Harris presented. In fact, for those of you who can remember, Marvin Harris was the first speaker at our conference in 1990, which Matthew and Richard attended, probably the only ones. I wonder if Bill Carpenter probably wasn't there, I don't know. But in any case, and he pointed out that the reason that the Aztecs killed all these prisoners and, you know, they tore their heart out with an obsidian knife and all on top of a pyramid, and then they threw the body down. Well, basically it was because there weren't any decent food animals in this part of the world since South America didn't, well, the whole of the Americas didn't have anything like cows and bullocks and so on. And so that here you have an empire that would make use of cannibalism as a source of protein. In other words, it was a kind of economic usefulness that drove that rather, you know, horrifying custom. So that from what I understand, cannibalism otherwise is basically symbolic. Like I noticed that even in the Islamic State, at certain points, they would eat the heart of the enemy. And that wasn't because they needed the protein, it was a symbolic gesture. And I think that it's pretty much established that, in other words, economically speaking, cannibalism, which is in a way opposed to this Girardian notion of the originary victim, that cannibalism is not the source of human culture. So I think on the other hand, it is a kind of a nightmare of human culture, a kind of a nightmare of the primary scene in the bad sense. In other words, this sort of bad dream that we have and that Freud saw as watching your parents have intercourse. But I mean, it's this sort of horrible thing that you can't think about. Of course, if your parents hadn't had intercourse, you wouldn't be there, but that's, but the term itself has this sort of resonance. So I think you have to be clear about the distinction that the basic point of the originary hypothesis is that the primary scene isn't dramatic. On the contrary, it's a kind of a comedy. You know, we start out by all being afraid of each other and being afraid to take the first piece. And then at the end, we discover that there's a kind of a will that's forcing us not to do that, and that gradually brings us into harmony as we exchange the sign, and then we come to the object and divide it up in a kind of nice way. And you know, there's plenty of evidence for that in the literature. I mean, the whole idea of the famous camel sacrifice. So I would look at Ellis's work, not that I've read it, I must say, you give me a desire to read it because it seems like a kind of horrible, but nevertheless, sort of extremism you can't help but learn something from. It's a sort of the bad dream of what humanity comes from. In other words, before you had the originary scene of humanity, there must have been plenty of violence. There must have been plenty of times when this alpha beta system was breaking down and the alpha animal, everyone suddenly on him and that kind of thing. And it's that aspect that the human saves us from, but we're always afraid that we came out of that because the human peace only is a result of our violence. And that all comes back to the basic definition of the human as the only creature that is more of a danger to itself than the rest of the world. Well, I think that's enough, but I think but you make a very good case for studying Ellis's work precisely because of that. And even the ambiguity of the end where you say that, you know, he seems to be killing these people, and maybe that's just a kind of a fantasy that says a lot about culture in general. Mm-hmm. All the violence in culture is really a fantasy, isn't it? Mm-hmm. All on the screen, the guy hitting somebody, there's nobody really getting killed. And so all that violence in the horror movies is a way of getting us back to the originary moment of peace. When we leave the theater, we're supposedly purged of, as Aristotle would put it, of violence and, pity and terror. So thanks very much for this interesting study.
Thanks.
It seems to me we have to move to our next talk. And thank you very much, Joachim, for this extremely illuminating talk. And our next speaker is Alexei Surin. Originally from Russia, Alexei moved to Israel 2 years ago. In Russia, he studied cultural studies and researched the problem of free will in the novels of modern relatively modern American authors like Kurt Vonnegut and Chuck Palahniuk through the prism of Frankfurt School philosophy. In the Department of Literature of Jewish People at the Bar-Ilan University, he is going to explore the problems of boundaries of language and overcoming the catastrophe in the works of Tolkien and Russian Israeli literature, which seems to be a kind of the perfect embodiment of a comparative approach, bringing together two very different things. And as a comparativist, I can't be but happy when reading about this kind of comparison. So, Alexei, please.
Yes, thank you so much for introduction. It's a big pleasure to be here tonight. And before I start, I wanted to say what in my lecture tonight, I'm going to focus only on Girard mimetic theory, because during preparation for my talk, I have seen what the concept of deferral of violence and Tolkien's works requires a separate examination. So I'm going to start, and now I want to share my screen. Just a second. I didn't see my presentation here. Really strange, just a second. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Now you see, right?
Yeah.
Uh-huh. Just 1 second. Yeah. Now it's okay. This presentation is an attempt to research René Girard's concept of the desired objects, the mimetic crisis, and rivalry in G.R.R. Tolkien's novel, The Lord of the Rings. Using Girard's mimetic theory, I want to show what Tolkien and Girard have primarily the same understanding of the nature of power, and equally so, the acquisitive desire for the power as a source of evil and violence, which could be overcome with the virtue of the imitation of Christ. As Tolkien said, quote, "The Lord of the Rings is, of course, a fundamentally religious and Catholic work. Unconsciously, so at first, but consciously in the revision. What is why I have not put in or have cut out practically all reference to anything like religion, to cults or practices in imaginary world, for the religious element is absorbed into the story and the symbolism." And I get end quote. And I guess what the mimetic theory of René Girard is especially helpful here in understanding Tolkien works precisely because Girard, like the author of Lords of the Rings, was Catholic and understood Christianity as the best antidote to violence and mimetic rivalry. René Girard's mimetic theory states that we desire objects because we see others desiring them. Human beings imitate each other, eventually giving rise to rivalries and women conflicts. Increase in rivalry leads to a mimetic crisis. Every member of society resembles each other in our pursuit of desire, and this lack of differentiation generates chaos. Quote, rivalry, Girard writes, does not arise because of the fortuitous convergence of two desires on a single object. Rather, the subject desires the object because the rival desires it. Girard developed this idea in his book, Things Hidden Since the Foundation of the World, the model being closely identified with the object he jealously keeps for himself possesses, so it would seem a self-sufficiency and omniscience what the subject can only dream of acquiring. End quote. This battle to possess an object Girard labels as accusative, saying accusative, quote, accusative mimesis divides by leading two or more individuals to convert not on one and the same object with a view of appropriating it. Thus, accusative negative desire, the desire which causes rivalry, violence, scapegoating, and undifferentiation in community is brought about by a limited object, an object desired by many, but only possessive by one. And in Gerard Tolkien's novel, G.R.R. Tolkien's novel, The Lord of the Rings, published in three volumes in 1954 and 1955, the object of desire, the One Ring, is imbued with the acquisitive desire of the Dark Lord, Sauron. The One Ring contained much of a Sauron's power. When the people of Middle-earth come into contact with the ring, they lose their ability to choose their desired model because the ring forces its own model, Sauron model, on them. The mimetic draw of the ring and Sauron's mediation is so powerful that it stamps nearly all characters who contact it to forget about the differences and throws the ring bearers into rivalry with Sauron. This leads to the loss of individuality and eventually causing the ring's bearer to fall into the same evil, but Sauron works in Middle-earth to imitate him in his endless and greedy desire for power. For example, in the scene when Boromir asks Frodo to show the ring, we see how the Steward Prince of Gondor mirrors Sauron in his desire for power. Boromir says to Frodo with anger that the ring should belong to him. Boromir demands to give him the ring and attacks Frodo. In this moment, Tolkien shows us one detail. Suddenly, he, Boromir, sprang over the stone and leaped at Frodo. His fair and pleasant face was hideously changed. A raging fire was in his eyes. End quote. Boromir contemplates using the One Ring against Sauron, but he does not notice how he set up in place of Sauron as a new Dark Lord in his desire to subjugate others. A fire flares up in Boromir's eyes, reminiscent of the flaming eye of Sauron. Lord of Rivendell, Elrond notes, the ring, the One Ring, is altogether evil. Its strength is too great for any person, and, quote, the desire of it corrupts the heart. Even wizards or wizards might be tempted to use its power to set themselves up as tyrants in Sauron's place. This situation happens to wizard Saruman, who falls to the temptation of power. Trapped in mimetic rivalry, he imitates and even becomes the double of the Dark Lord Sauron. For example, in the Fellowship of the Ring, Gandalf recalls the conversation with Saruman. His former ally and superior revealed his corruption. Saruman told Gandalf, I'm a Saruman the Vice, Saruman Ring Maker. The fact that he wears a ring and calls himself a Ring Maker signifies that he is just a copy of the real Ring Maker, Dark Lord Sauron. Through Saruman, Tolkien shows us what envy is imitative at its root, and envy inevitably transforms the one who desires into a lesser copy of his rival. Almost the same happens with Colin. A hobbit Smeagol, feeling jealous, killed his relative hobbit Deagle to take the One Ring for himself. The destructive effects of the ring turned Smeagol into Gollum, a pitiful creature whose consciousness is completely absorbed in this object of desire, the ring. Taking possession of the precious, as Colin calls the ring, and he also falls under the desire to copy Sauron. For example, Gollum fantasized about becoming Lord Smeagol. Quote, perhaps we grow very strong, stronger and brave, he says. Lord Smeagol, Gollum the Great, the Gollum, most precious Gollum, must have it. We want it. Another example of triangle of mimetic desire we see in the stand of Bill when Bilbo and Frodo first meeting after a long separation, then both of them, not only Bilbo, are already poisoned by the destructive power of the One Ring. Two relative hobbits cannot be with each other in the same room, tormented by the impulse to possess the object of desire. Quote, Frodo quickly drew back the ring. To his distress and amazement, he found that he was no longer looking at Bilbo. A shadow seemed to have fallen between them, and through it, he found himself eyeing a little wrinkled creature with a hungry face and bony, groping hands. He felt a desire to strike him. End quote. In this description, Frodo sees Bilbo the image of Gollum, who in turn copies Sauron. Interestingly, Bilbo sometimes calls the ring his precious, and through this way enters into mimetic relationship with the object of desire by copying Gollum. However, not all characters succumb to dark influence of the One Ring. For example, the Lady Galadriel, one of the greatest of the elves in Middle Earth, resists the temptation to take the ring from Frodo. She says, quote, in place of the Dark Lord, you will set up a queen, and eyes shall not be dark, but beautiful and terrible as the morning and the night. As a result, Galadriel refuses to touch the ring, saying, I pass the test. I will diminish and go into the West and remain Galadriel. So she does not give in to mimetic desire and remains with her individuality. Galadriel is not one of the novel's characters who all recognize the ring as a path towards the loss of individuality, who realize what the ring will twist loose, who bear it into another Sauron, lesser perhaps, but just as corrupt. Galadriel is free from negative mimesis. The capacity to avoid the greedy desire for power provides this freedom for positive mimesis. According to René Girard, a positive side of mimetic desire is making humans capable of freedom in the Christian sense of imitating Christ. We must imitate Jesus as he imitates God, generous and without the desire for power and domination. And according to Girard, Christ shows us how to release our desires, not by forbidding desire, but by giving us a new model, imitating Christ in trusting God. And James Warren, who explored René Girard's mimetic theory in his work Compassion or Apocalypse is a comprehensible guide to the thought of René Girard, writes, quote, as the gospel presents humanity, these two options, either imitate Christ, giving up all mimetic violence, or run the risk of self-destruction, end quote. Humanity finds itself approaching a world by sacrificial crisis, a confused, blurred confrontation of all against all. The nonviolent, forgiving, compassionate, and self-giving Christ, according to Warren, represents the only life-giving alternative to violent destruction. And suppose Warren says, we imitate Christ rather than each other. In that case, Christ offers the real power to break the hold of humanity's satanic bondage to scandalous mimetic rivalry and the escalation of reciprocal violence, but it's produced. So, back in The Lord of the Rings, if Sauron in The Lord of the Rings tempting others to imitate himself represents satanic mimetic rivalry, or according to Tolkien's own word, satanic rebellion, there are characters who represent the opposite side and imitate Christ. For example, Gandalf. Like Christ, Gandalf sacrificed himself for his friends and the manes of Moria, and later rises again, changed and glorified. Another character of the book, Aragorn, like Christ, has left his kingdom, is destined to return and regain his throne. Like Christ, Aragorn does not strive for power, but perceives power as a cross, what he must bear. For example, when Aragorn comes to Minas Tirith, to Gondor, whereas the Denethor, steward of Gondor, rules and must transfer power, it's already clear that Aragorn is the future rightful king of Gondor, but he does not take power. He enters a Minas Tirith to heal people who are bounded because the king, like Christ, has the power to heal. But when he sets up a tent outside of the city to not pressure the governor of Gondor, so what is the transfer of power occurs voluntary, and not because Aragorn wants it, not because he puts pressure on the ruling steward, but because he knows what being the ruler of Gondor is his burden, his duty. And here Aragorn managed to overcome evil and reign in a new era of peace and healing between nations of Middle-earth. In this aspect, he represents Christ of the Second Coming, a Christ figure who will reign over a world cleansed from evil and peace. At peace. Hobbit Frodo is the most crucial example of imitating Christ in The Lord of the Rings. The willingness to sacrifice himself entirely for the good of the world out of love makes Frodo similar to Christ. Frodo knew taking the ring to Mordor was almost certain to lead to his death. As critic Sean McGrath writes, quote, the questor for life, whose quest leads him to choose death, is a distinctly Christian archetype. An echo of the words of Jesus in the Gospel of John, the man who loves his life will lose it, while the man who hates his life in the world will keep it for eternal life. And like Christ, Frodo must die for the sin of the whole world, as he explains to Sam upon leaving Middle-earth. Quote, when things are in danger, someone has to give them up. lose them, so but others may live. Similarly, Jesus loses his life, so what others may keep theirs. I want to emphasize that unlike Christ, Frodo fails, but this doesn't mean what the Hobbit ceases to be a Christ-like figure. In my opinion, Christ-like mercy and pity what Frodo had shown toward Gollum and ensured the success of the Hobbit's dreadful quest and the salvation of Middle-earth. We can be obedient instruments not only of negative desire, but to choose a positive side in imitating Christ. And as Christians, Giraud and Tolkien ultimately acknowledge that desire for power is the result of attempting to make a rival out of God and each other, what we desire to dominate others and finally replace God. At the same time, both and Giraud and Tolkien think what we can imitate Christ without possessiveness can achieve freedom and go beyond the language of violence. For Tolkien, story of Christ is the story of unexpected rescue, a new catastrophe or good catastrophe. New catastrophe is a concept introduced by Tolkien himself. The writer coined the word by affixing the Greek prefix eu, meaning good, to word catastrophe. The good catastrophe describes the sudden miraculous turn from sorrow and horror to joy that rescues the story from disaster on the brink of tragedy. In the essay on fair stories written by Tolkien in 1939, he argues that eucatastrophe is a true form of fairy tale and its highest function. Moreover, Tolkien claims that a vision of eucatastrophe occurs not only in the imaginary world, but in the real one. Here he turns to the New Testament and writes, quote, "The birth of Christ is a new catastrophe of man's history. The resurrection is a new catastrophe of the story of incarnation." Thus, the new catastrophe is what happens in the climax of the Lord of the Rings. How you remember, Frodo fails and his quest at its very end, claiming the ring for himself. However, at this moment, Gollum suddenly appears, steals the ring, and his ecstatic gloating falls into the fire of Mount Doom. If not for Frodo's previous mercy in saving Gollum's life, evil was celebrating victory. But evil is defeated through a small act of mercy, an act of rejection of greed and violence, what is based on the imitation of Christ. Like Tolkien, René Girard sees imitation of Christ as the way to avoid envy, rivalry, violence, and destruction. In his book, I see Satan fall like lightning. He asks, and through this quote, I would like to finish my presentation. So, quote, "Why does Jesus regard the Father and himself as the best model for all humans?" And his answer is, "Because neither the Father nor the Son desires greedily, egoistically. God makes his Son rise on the evil and on the God and the good, and he sends his rain on the just and on the unjust. God gives to us without counting, without marking the least difference between us. He lets the wheat grow with the wheat until the time of harvest. if we imitate the detached generosity of God, when the trap of mimetic rivalries will never close over us. Thank you so much for listening. For me, it was first time, first presentation in English, so I'm a little bit worried. And if you have some comments, please. Thank you.
Alexei, thank you very much for this extremely interesting talk. And I do have a comment, but mm-hmm. still, I would prefer not to begin with myself. So please, questions, comments. I can add a very brief comment. It seems to me in continuation of what Alexei said, and as it seems in the line with the general GA perspective and Erigan's earlier comment that the essence of being human is the deference of violence. And it seems to me that in Tolkien there is somehow a mid-ground possibility between the active participation in this mimetic desire and the self-sacrifice. There is also a possibility not taking this. Like Gandalf when Frodo proposes this ultimate object of desire, this ultimate object of power and suppression and everything. And then Frodo says, it should be yours. Gandalf says, no, mm-hmm. just put it on the carpet. It's years probably before, or a long time before the self-sacrifice. It's just, no, there is mimetic desire. I know it. I'm not a part of it. And then Galadriel duplicates it.
Mm-hmm.
She's tempted. She disfigures. She changes. Yeah. And then she's not that she's completely free from this power of the desire from the desire for violence. But then comes this moment of the deference of violence. And she says, no, it's not for me. I'm remaining myself. And this says probably not remaining human, remaining an elf, but we know what this means. And then once again, it seems to me all the hobbits, they can take the ring basically anytime and they decide, no, we don't until this very last moment when Frodo is too tempted, alone, exhausted. He is too tempted by this presence of the collective mimetic desire, and there is a moment of hesitation. But it seems to me that there is also middle ground between the taking an active part in the mimetic desire and conversely the the imitating of the self-sacrifice. And this is simply, no, I'm not a part of this. I don't want this. I want this. I know that I want this and I don't want this. And this is the deference of design, the deference of violence.
Mm-hmm. I see the element of deferral of violence in our part of the book. And in my opinion, deferral of violence happens suddenly there is a moment, for example, in the book when Frodo attempt to put a ring on Arthur things, and in this moment he hears music from elves, and in this moment he forgot about drink, about temptation, and just in this moment he just listening music. So I think that music and songs of elves, the most culturally orientated, I think, creatures in Tolkien's world, his function, their function here, as they represent here a culture, what creates a significant differences and relieves mimetic tension at the very moment of crisis when the differences are arise and ready to turn into violence. So I think music of elves is a sign, is a culture what through ritual of violence works here in Lord of the Rings, in my opinion.
Yeah, thank you, Alexei. And it seems to be there is also a very different but also a comparable moment when mm-hmm. Gollum is actually caught by Gandalf, and then yes. Frodo said, what's a pity that you didn't kill him? And mm-hmm. Sure. Gandalf says, no. And then we understand retrospectively that this moment of unjustified pity was the moment of salvation. The deference of violence was the mm-hmm. moment that eventually saved everybody in the end of the book. Matt, please.
Yeah, absolutely right.
I just wanted to ask, Alexei, what is the symbolism of the ring itself? It's called the Ring of Power.
Mm-hmm.
But does the ring, in your view, symbolize violence or
I think power or first of all, I think symbol of ring is a desire for power, and what's why in the beginning of book we can read one ring to rule them all, one ring to find them. So this is a mimetic desire for power. What's my opinion?
Okay, so here's a related question then.
Mm-hmm.
Does the book then, and it's more than just a book, it's like a whole mythological system, right?
Yeah,
it's
absolutely.
It's great that your paper came in the wake of Bill's paper about epic, because I think Lord of the Rings is an attempt to try to create a modern epic, you know, to take all of the great epics of the past and combine them into this one great epic for our times.
Mm-hmm.
So does the necessity to destroy the ring mean mm-hmm. pacifism, the complete getting rid of violence altogether, or is it more complicated than that? This is something I've been thinking about in connection with Girard. I just read the biography of Girard mm-hmm. by Cynthia Haven, and she makes the point that Girard was not a pacifist.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Even though he's anti-violence, he's not a pacifist. And I'm just trying to work my head around that. Is that kind of what we're looking at here? Because to destroy the ring is to employ violence in the destruction of violence, which you would think would just put you back in that same kind of mimetic cycle, right?
Mm-hmm.
But here, this seems to be the solution to the problem. If you get rid of this one ring, mm-hmm. you will secure the future of Middle Earth. So, but is it a kind of double bind? Is it that problem of using violence to get rid of violence?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think I need to explore this question. It's hard to me to answer spontaneously.
That's fair. I've been fascinated by that. I've never read the books, but I know the movies really well.
Okay. Yeah.
And I assume that the movies follow the books pretty closely.
Yeah.
But that's the one question that I'm always mm-hmm. struggling with.
If I may jump in, actually, just following up on Matt's question.
Yeah.
It occurs to me when you, I mean, I'm not, my wife is a Tolkien fan, but I'm not, but that doesn't matter. She's told me the story many times and she's read it multiple times. And I have seen the movies because my kids watched them. But your summary of the ending, you gave it kind of a positive twist because, you know, Gollum is saved by Frodo's mercy.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, that's how the ring gets destroyed. I mean, Gollum has to go with him. But what Matt was saying about you have to use violence to destroy, that's perfectly, there it is, right? I mean, Gollum's got to go. There's no way not to scapegoat somebody.
No. Yeah, agree. It's also reduplicating violence, and then they declare their program, the political program for the day after, and it's extremely violent.
Mm-hmm.
So it seems to me that this is high time for completing this section. I have to many thanks to Alexei for this extremely interesting talk.
Thank you so much.
Good night to everybody who is going to sleep, and have a nice day to everybody who doesn't.
All right, see you tomorrow.
Thank you so much.
And guys, don't forget, tomorrow it's 4:30. Tomorrow we start a little earlier, okay? Just check your time.
So everything will be
4:30 Jerusalem time.
Okay.
I'll try to be up, but I might not be. Sorry about that, Ian. But
6:30 in the morning in Los Angeles, so
I have to get to campus to get to my computer. So there's some transit involved.
4:30.
You know, there was some mention about refuting Fleming and O'Carroll earlier this afternoon. And I just want to remind you, this is going to be an opportunity for you to refute Fleming and Dennett. You know? Might be something attractive in that, you know? I mean, you can see us in the many instant replays, of course, afterwards. But if you really want to argue with us, and we're kind of likely to be someone you might want to argue with, I know it's a sacrifice, but okay.
Seems to me.
Good night.
Yeah.
Thank you, everybody.
Ron, please, as the main moderator, I'm just getting the microphone back.
All right. Thank you.
In the morning.
Thank you.